Hatman here. You might be listening. You might not. If you are, hi. Let's begin. Got a quote here, and it's quite a profound one for me. The songs of our ancestors are the songs of our children. Philip Carr Com. I was listening to a radio program on BBC recently. It was a sunny day. I'd been off to see my friend in Bristol and I was driving back around about midday. It was quite beautiful and I was on my way to see some friends in the evening. So I was channel hopping on the radio and one particular interview came up on Radio 4. It was about a guy called Benjamin Ferencz. That's Ferencz. It had a massive impact on me, this interview. So if you can find it or read up about him, please do so. So it's Benjamin Ferencz. His background is he was a Romanian immigrant to New York. When he arrived in New York in pre-World War II, he couldn't speak any English. 7 years of age with his dad, he was taken to school, but because he couldn't speak any English, they turned him away. Eventually, he learned the language and he studied hard and he managed to get a scholarship to Harvard Law. Everything was going great. Years went on, and then Pearl Harbor happened with the Japanese. And like a lot of young Americans then, he decided he needed to do his piece. So he went to sign up, and he wanted to join the Marines. He was 5'2". He says 5'1½", but records might show he's 5'2". And the Marines said, nah, get out of here. And he wanted to be in the Air Force. And they said, well, no, you can't because you're too short. You won't reach the pedal, so you won't be able to fly. So you can't do that. But he still wanted to do his bit. And he signed up for the infantry in the Army. He went to World War II, went to Europe, and he fought in the five big battles. And he got 5 stars. I think they were blue stars or something, which represented each battle, and he was in all of the big ones, and he experienced a number of horrible things, as I'm sure all military personnel and families know, but his journey involved some of the concentration camps, and he went there and he found the scenes of horror, the mountains of body piled up on each other. You couldn't tell if someone was dead or alive, it was only if the eyes moved. And anyway, part of his job was then going through the records that the camps all kept, and he came across evidence of a SS group of 3,000 strong that would follow the army through the German army through their advancements. And of course the Germans would go through and push these 3,000. What they would do is go around and gather up all the Jews and kill them. And they killed million people, according to their own records. He handed all the evidence, and he went back to the US, met his wife, and thinking he'll never go back to war again. And then a call came up. They needed somebody to look at the records again, and he was asked to go up there. He went through the evidence. It was quite clear what was going on, but they said, listen, we've got many fish to fry. We're going to have to let these guys go. He fought for this. He was quite discouraged. He said, no, I'm not having that. We have to do this. We've got their own evidence. And his commanding officer at the time said, have you ever been in a court before? And he said, I've never been in a courtroom before. But I've got the evidence, and the evidence in their own words will get them. So he prosecuted 22 people. He's the eldest living prosecutor from the Nuremberg trials. He's 97 now and lives in Florida. So of the 22, four of them were hung, and the others were eventually, it turned out they were released, because as the trials were going on, he was in Patton's group, and Patton said, right, let's change our attitudes now. We've done the Germans, let's go after the Russians. And what happened, all those people for life imprisonment and those others waiting to be executed, they were just set free. And this was something that just touched me. How this man could actually live with this. But his story of what it was and how he chose these out of the 3,000 strong, and they had them all. How did he choose the 22? And he said it was the most intelligent, the most educated, the highest ranks. And he said essentially that all men in war will become barbaric murderers. All men will do it. And he prosecuted 22, and he was the oldest living, and he convicted the most. And these were his stories. And if you listen to the interview, it's wonderful. There's a moment towards the end, the woman says, "You sound so sprightly." And indeed, he did. And he said, "Well, I'm 97 now." And she said, "Well, if you don't mind me asking, what keeps you so young?" He said, "Young lady, please don't, because if my wife hears this, we'll probably have our first argument after like 50 years." So it was a bit of flirting from this old guy with a beautiful, horrific story. And his answer to how does he keep himself so fit, he says mentally he needs to stay fit. And the way he does it mentally, he goes the physical routes. Every morning, 97 years of age in Florida, he wakes up and he does 100 press-ups every morning before he starts the day. He goes swimming every day, and he goes for a walk. And he's got a number, I think it was yoga as well, he does, but he does a number of physical activities throughout the day. He was quite a charming guy, and he also said about all the money he's been made from his, I think he's written some books and presentations. He gives all his money away to Jewish causes and charities with a view to get making laws, not war. And it was coming to the end of the interview, and the woman said to him, "Well, if I may, what is it? If there's something I could do, what could I do on this? Because you've inspired me." And he said, "Dear lady, one day I will be dead. And when I'm gone, I'd like you to take the flame and carry it on for me." And at that moment, I just burst into tears with this guy. He was almost the perfect man in my world. And then I got thinking, like, I mean, crikey, what a legacy. Then I got worried, well, what's my legacy? And it was, I mean, I've got some, I have a business, but it does things and stuff, but it's not really a legacy there. I've got some property, it's not really a legacy there. And I've got some savings, and I've got some life cover, so my children will be fine. But I thought, well, what's my legacy? And I really thought about this. I had to pull over on the motorway, the service station, safely. And I was thinking, and my son, he's 18 now, my daughter's 22, and they're my world. And I'm at a stage now where I, as I'm sure all parents strive to be, unconditional love. I support them, and I look to guide them. And I know our conversations aren't taking more of that role. And I thought, well, when I'm talking to my son at 18, what's he thinking when I'm talking to him? He's probably going, "Yeah, Dad, nice one." And I thought, well, my daughter, and she's going, "Yeah, Dad, nice one." And it's lovely conversations, but I can't really live in their world because I don't actually know their world. And, of an age. I don't know what it's like being 22 or 18 today, but I do know what it's like from a vague memory when I was 22 and when I was 18. And I thought about my dad. And I'm of my age, and my dad's an old man. And if I were to talk to him, I ain't gonna listen to him, because he doesn't get it. Because he doesn't know what my world's like. And I just thought, this is quite sadness. And I thought my mum would probably send down some feelings from above about this. So I started thinking about my legacy. Benjamin's done his thing. But try as I may, I do want to connect with my children. But I'm not sure how. If you can cast your mind back to when you were 18, we knew the world, didn't we? And our parents would say, "You can't do that, you can't do this, don't do the other." Yeah. And then we did it. I don't have an insight to young people's worlds, and sadly, disconnect. Young people don't know our world; they don't know our feelings and our hopes. So it's a two-way thing. This about the connectivity, and I thought that was quite a sadness. And then I thought, well, I don't. It's too late for me now. But if I was to write down what it's like being 51, about some of my dreams, my hopes, my aspirations, my fears, my worries, my concerns, what I'm looking forward to, what I want more of, what I want less of, what I'm excited about, and what I'm worried about, and who should I call? What should I? All if I just write down maybe just one letter, when my son or my daughter, they get to 51, they could be having their moments going, oh, you know. Maybe time looking for a guidance, a compass, somebody to talk to. I'll be of an age. I might not have my marbles. I might have some of them. But I thought then, wouldn't it be lovely that, say, my daughter at 51 and I sat down and we just had a conversation. And I said, well, you know what, sweetheart? I don't know what your world is like at 51. But I'll tell you what my world was like. Shall we have a look? And then from 51 onwards, I'm going to have a letter. At 51, at 52, 53, etc., etc., etc. And I thought maybe once a year we could just sit down and just share things together about what it was like. And I thought, what kind of conversations could we have then? How much different? Because we're then sitting from like-minded. We'd have so many similarities. Yeah, there'd be generational differences, but maybe an insight to who and what each other are. And I thought, well, if my son and daughter then at 51 could do it, when their children got to 51. They could be having a conversation, and mum or dad could then say, well, here's what my life was like at 51. And here's what granddad, I probably, you know, I hope to meet my grandchildren, but I might be gone. But wouldn't it be nice? Maybe all these letters were kept together. It's too late for me now. I have to start at 51, but maybe we started maybe at 18 or 19 or whatever age you are now. You just write down a letter for your children for when they are older. And then you can all sit down together and have quality time to really listen and learn about each other. So my hope is that from this man in a hat, he just wears a hat, I do just wear a hat, is that we do share things, maybe record things for our children. So when they get to that age, yes, give them your love, unconditional love, the support, the direction, but maybe share with them your fears, your hopes, your dreams and aspirations. And maybe that could strengthen your connectivity. And maybe this could be your legacy, that your dad, your mum, was always there. You might not be there tomorrow. You might not be there in 20, 30, 40 years' time. One day you will be gone, like Benjamin said. One day I'll be gone. And when I'm gone, I want you to carry on with the legacy. Take the flame with me. You can, sorry, not legacy. Take the flame. Carry on with the flame. And I thought, well, maybe we could do that. So HATMAN is saying, let's write letters for our children about what it's like at our age. So when they hit that pivotal moment at that same age, you can share, and maybe that could help the connectivity. Wouldn't it also be nice that you're gone when they hit maybe 51, and you're there to offer your words and thoughts, and maybe that would be a really supportive, loving, guiding parent, maybe a grandson, great grandson, grandma. Great grandma. So, however it works in your own ways, I'm sure you found how it will do it. But I think this would be a legacy that I could leave for the world. I'm sure you have yours, but it's my idea. For me, it suits me. So, just got a quote for you, really, if I may. People get discouraged, and they should remember, for me, it takes courage not to be discouraged. Benjamin Ferencz. Thanks, Ben. With all the hatred in this world, I want it to be a magical world. It's been hard and I have been discouraged, but I'm going to be courageous now. Hatman out. Thank you.